Hello, welcome to our next talk. Our next talk is held by Fiona Weber. They work at Wobcom in Wolfsburg. Wobcom is heavily automating their network. They also had some talks at previous DNOC conferences about their automation. This year, it's the next step. It's their project from this year, I would say, how to enhance their DNS service for their customers.
Thank you for having me. So today I will talk a bit about Anycast DNS resolvers. In my opinion, DNS resolvers are one of the most important infrastructure pieces of an internet service provider. If the DNS resolvers fail, then the services are quite useless for most customers. So it's important to get these right. There are a lot of guides online about how to set up authoritative Anycast DNS servers, but there's almost nothing about recursors, so that's why I'm talking about that today. First, some things about me. I'm Fiona Weber, also known as Vidista. I work for Wobcom, which is a local ISP from Wolfsburg and which also operates a backbone through Germany. And I'm also one of the co-founders of InfraRun, which is a hosting co-op which runs video conferencing and other web applications for educational institutions. We founded in the beginning of the pandemic so that schools would not have to use Microsoft Teams or Zoom and so on. I'm also running some Freifunk servers, and I'm helping some NGOs with their network and server stuff. So first, what again is a DNS resolver and how does it work? DNS is a hierarchy, so to find out the answer to our query, we have to traverse it. That process is called iterative resolution or recursing. So not every resolver is a recursor. For example, there is a resolver in your router at home, but that one probably won't be a recursor. It will just forward the request to another server, which in most cases then is a recursor. And that are the kind of machines or systems we are talking about today. So when our recursor gets a request, it will traverse the whole DNS zone. So, for example, if we want to look up de.wikipedia.org, our server will first ask the root zone, then the root zone will tell it to look at the designated servers for .org. Those will forward them to the server for Wikipedia and so on till it gets its answer. Yeah, so why should a network provider run their own recursor? I mean, there are some public available servers of Cloudflare or Google and so on, but why should we run our own infrastructure? First of all, maybe the most obvious reason would be privacy. So we don't want to feed the data of our customers to the big US corporations. Then there is resilience. So even hyperscalers like Cloudflare have outages, and when that happens, we can't do anything about it. So when we have our own outages, then we at least are able to fix our own outages. Then there is latency. So we want the resolver to be as near as possible to the customer to have local caching. Because when a customer opens a website, the first thing their browser will do is ask for a DNS query. And before having the answer for that query, the browser can't do anything. And the hyperscalers running the servers like 1111 or 8888 have maybe 3 or 4 POPs in Germany, and you as a local internet service provider probably are nearer your user than any of those providers ever could be. Then there is network utilization. So some CDN providers still do their traffic steering via DNS. That works in a way that the CDN providers will ping probe your DNS resolvers and try to figure out which of their POP is nearest in term of latency. And then it will give your DNS resolver the answer to access the nearest POP. If you ask 8888 for a query, then you will get the answer which maybe is optimal for the Google network, but not the one for your network. And even if you run your own DNS resolvers, you want to do it distributed, because if your resolvers are in Frankfurt and your user is in Berlin, you probably the CDN provider will point your user to their POP in Frankfurt, which will cost you a lot of money because you have to carry all the traffic up to Berlin. So now let's have a look at how a traditional resolver setup works to see how we can improve it using Anycast. This is a fairly typical DNS server setup in a small to medium-sized network. There is a layer 2 subnet with two DNS servers, and we have two IP addresses, which we both will give our customer, who then will round robin or just ask the first one till requests time out and so on. And then we have one router connected. So what can go wrong with these kinds of setups? First of all, you as a network person probably think of network problems like spanning tree, broadcast storms, like normal layer 2 problems that occur in legacy networks. This would be a catastrophic failure, since then both of your DNS resolvers would be down. Then there could be gateway problems, for example, a router that breaks down, or even if you have two routers using layer 2 redundancy protocols, there could be a problem with the failover because the control plane is overloaded or something like that. This would also be a catastrophic failure. Then your whole site, of course, could go down, which of course would be catastrophic. But there also are less catastrophic failures, like a single server becoming unavailable, for example, because of a hardware breakdown or maybe a maintenance, and your servers can get overloaded. So some networks maybe already suffered some of these failure modes and thought about, how can we fix these? And they came up with a more advanced solution. So they put one of the two resolvers into a different site and connected it to a different router. This indeed solves some of our failure modes. For example, layer 2 problems won't take us down because, well, our DNS resolvers are in different layer 2 domains. Same with gateway problems, because they are connected to different gateways. Or if a whole site goes down, then there's still the other one. Still, we have the problems of a single server becoming unavailable or a server being overloaded. So all of these failure modes don't take us down completely, but they will severely degrade the user experience for our customers, since they have to wait for a timeout till they ask the next server. So how do we fix this? Of course, the title of the talk is stating Anycast. What is Anycast, you may ask yourself now? It's basically just multiple servers sharing the same IP addresses and the network routing the packets to the nearest servers. So you could say you are using the network as a load balancer. Let's have a look at a simple Anycast setup to understand how this works. This is maybe the most simple setup you can imagine. You have two servers in two sites, again, connected to different routers. And as you can see, they have a unique IP address, which is in cyan here, and they have a shared IP address, which is in pink here. Okay. Now we just look at the life of a typical DNS request in such setup to understand how this works together. In a normal setup, you probably would assign your DNS servers multiple Anycast addresses, because customers are used to talk to multiple IP addresses. But there's just one for simplicity here. So we have our customer who wants to resolve, for example, facetube.org or whatever. So it sends out that request to the IP address with the 100 in our example here, with the 100 in the last octet. And our router will look at that packet, will make a lookup in its routing table and sees, the next one I have is rightly connected here. I will send it to that one and forwards the packet there. Then our resolver will look at that packet, sees, I don't have that in my cache, and maybe talks to the internet to find out what the answer to that query is. For that communication, it has to use its unique IP address, because how do we ensure otherwise that the right resolver will receive the answer again? So if we would use the Anycast address, then in this example, for the other resolver would receive the answer and then discard it because it doesn't know what to do with it. So if one of our DNS resolvers goes down, then our network will notice, because our network will just reroute it to the next available server. But how does this work? So the younger ones maybe learned in school, the others learned by pain, that you are not allowed to use the same IP address multiple times in layer 2 segments. This will receive an ARP flapping, or if you are using the same MAC address in map flapping, which is probably even worse. So we need a different way to tell our routers where to find our address. And that's where we need routing. So how does our router know where to find the address? We of course could log into all of our routers, set some static routes, and if one of our resolvers go down, we have to log into all servers and remove that route to reroute it. That's not practical. We need a routing protocol. And why not just use BGP? Because we are using BGPs anyways. So other routing protocols would work perfectly fine too, but BGP is just most common, and we will just stick to that. So how do we talk BGP to a server? We need to install a routing daemon. In this talk, I'm showing you BERT and XRBGP, which both are quite simple BGP daemons. There are also other ones, like for example FRR or Quagga, which also work perfectly fine, but maybe we want to keep it simple here. BERT also speaks other routing protocols and has some extensive options for filtering and so on. XRBGP is quite simple, and you can relatively easy implement low-tech health checks, which we will talk about later. So to announce an IP address, we first need an IP address. So let's have a look at a config snippet for if up, down, to. For example, we need to have an interface to assign our address. And as we have learned, we can't assign it to our layer 2 interface towards the router. So we will just assign it to the loopback address, as we already know from our backbone routers where we do the same. And we don't have to take care of the outgoing sockets, because our kernel automatically will use the unique IP address for outgoing requests, because that one is directly connected to the interface where our default route lives. So let's have a look at a example routing daemon config here for BERT 1. First of all, we import the routes on our interface LO, which is the loopback interface. And then we set up a BGP session with our router. Don't forget to set some filter rules, because you don't want to have things go wrong here. Now we do this on a few servers and have a look at a router. And yes, it works. We see our we look up our Anycast address and we see multiple next hops. So our server will now just load balance the requests between these three hosts. So now we have our routing DEM, but still nothing that answers our DNS requests. So let's have a look at the DNS recursor software. There are three software choices which I would recommend, which are PowerDNS Recursor, Unbound, and NotResolver. They are all pretty fast in benchmark. Unbound generally seems to perform best, but in the end it doesn't matter. They are all pretty fast. There is also different software. For example, there is Bind, which is commonly used, but Bind is quite complex software. It's not just a resolver. It's more like a full-blown DNS Swiss Army knife. And maybe for such an important service, you want something where you can read through the whole documentation and understand all the config options and so on. So have a look at those three software choices. Bonus points if you use two implementations, because theoretically it could be that there's a bug in one of the implementations, and for example, if it's possible to crash a server with a malicious payload, then that would hopefully only affect one of the implementations. But this of course also comes with increased maintenance effort, so really think about if you need this. Okay, now we have our routing daemon, we have our DNS recursor. The talk is stating high availability in the title. And we kind of already have high availability, because if one of our servers go down, then the BGP hold timer will expire and our network will reroute it. But there are some more things that can go wrong with a DNS resolver. That's why we need self-health checks. So essentially, we want to drain the server if something goes wrong. There are different ways to implement this. The most obvious would be to run a systemd timer or cron job and stop the routing daemon if things look fishy. Then there are more sophisticated options. You could manipulate, for example, the export filters based on the server's health. This could be a good idea, especially if you don't want to wake up the network department because a BGP session goes down, just because you are upgrading your DNS resolver or whatever. There is a really nice software suite for Bird to do this, which I have linked here. Take a look at it. It's really cool. You can manipulate the export filters with it. But talking about health checks, there was a Facebook outage a few weeks ago where they took down all their authoritative DNS servers with health checks because parts of their network were broken and they couldn't talk to the main control plane. So we want to get this right. The internet is decentral, and how do we really know if something's broken on our end or if it's someone else's infrastructure that's broken? So we don't want to take us offline when, for example, Facebook or Cloudflare go down. The most obvious check would be to see if the daemon is running at all. Then we could check if the daemon is accepting connections. For example, we could use the TCP DNS for that. So we are just opening a socket and look if the DNS resolver accepts our socket. Then we could add a local DNS zone to check this. With most of these software suites, you probably would also have to run a small authoritative server to point to. But that could be pretty nice. And you could, of course, check if multiple independent major websites are resolvable. So if Facebook, Cloudflare, Google, and Amazon are offline, there's a great chance that something is wrong on your end and not on their end. But still, with these sophisticated health checks, things can go wrong in ways you don't expect. So put a safety rope in there. Instead of pulling the routes, just increase the MET. And if all your DNS resolvers at once decide to drain themselves, they will have the same MET again, and the network will continue to route traffic to them. So that's a pretty neat trick. So what else do we need for high availability? Of course, we need monitoring or alerting, because, well, some things we want to know before they break, if they are going to break. And an obvious option to do that would be to monitor the software metrics, so queries per second, the cache hit ratio, etc. So if your cache hit ratio goes down drastically, there probably is something going wrong. Maybe not on your end, but you would want to have an engineer take a look at it. Great ways to do that when you are running a Prometheus stack are Unbound Exporter or PowerDNS Recursor Prometheus endpoint, which is built into PowerDNS Recursor, which is quite neat. Then you would want to monitor some server metrics, so the general load, memory usage, but also how many sockets are open, does the contract table look like if you're doing contracting, so you know when your server is saturated before that happens. With Prometheus, again, you can use Node Exporter and Systemd Exporter to check that. And of course, you also would want to implement some end-to-end tests. So periodically send some queries to the unique IP address of your server and see how long they take to resolve, or if they resolve at all. For Prometheus, you can use the Blackbox Exporter to do that. So now we have our servers. We ensured that they are high available. What's the next step? Well, we have to think about where to put our servers in the first place. And as I already mentioned in the beginning, we want to optimize on latency. So we want to put the server as close as possible to our customer. That could be, for example, putting a DNS resolver in every bigger city. Also, we would want to keep failure domains small. So we want to avoid big VM clusters with shared storage and so on, because if they go down, then a whole bunch of DNS resolvers will go down, and maybe the ones left will be overwhelmed by the requests and bad things will happen. What we are doing for that is we throw lone hypervisors in every bigger POP. So every of our POPs that has a full table capable router has a small VM hypervisor that is running DNS resolvers, but also some other neat pieces of infrastructure. For example, authoritative DNS servers, probes to monitor the network from within, route servers, speed test servers, etc., etc. So that could be a nice idea. Okay, so now we know where to put our servers. Let's think about how to scale it up. We have our servers. How does that work? The most obvious option with Anycast, of course, would be to scale them horizontally. We just build more of them and then enable multipathing on our routers. That works extremely well with Anycast DNS servers, because connections are really short-lived. So most of the time, it will just be one request as a UDP packet and one answer. But even with TCP requests, it's quite short-lived. So if a rerouting will happen, there's a great chance that the user will still get their answer. Then how do we scale our servers vertically? So we would want to optimize the cache hit ratios, because if more users are using a server, there's a higher chance that requests are already cached in its memory. There are different options to do that. One big factor, of course, would be the software choice and the software tunables. So there are a lot of parameters you can tune. And of course, the machine sizing. There are no general recommendations about the machine sizing because usage patterns vary vastly. For example, in our network, most of the clients have a caching resolver in their home router. So we generally will have a lower caching hit rate, but also less requests than, for example, a campus network with the same size of users would have. In our setup, one core per few thousand households works extremely well. You also would want to keep some headroom because outages like the Facebook outage a few weeks ago do happen, and then your resolvers have to deal with maybe double the traffic as they normally would, and it's even more expensive traffic because they have to track all the questions and wait for the answer that will never arrive and so on. So have some headroom. Then we can do some more fine-grained tuning. So if we want to scale to really big servers, we want to increase the number of source ports available in the server, in the kernel. We want to increase the contract table size if we are using contracting. We want to increase the buffer sizes for our UDP stack. And we want to increase the U-limits, so our DNS resolver is allowed to keep open a lot of sockets. If we run really, really big servers, we also would want to tune the NIC parameters, so the number of queues, the buffer sizes, etc. Okay, then how do we set up our servers? Now we know what we want to build, how do we do this? We definitely want to automate this because we need a lot of identical servers, and bolting them together by hand is super error prone and also a lot of work. So you want automation. Also you need automation to being able to deploy more servers quickly. So if there is a event like a big outage or whatever, some behavior somewhere changes, then you will be able to deploy more machines in short time. So have automation stacks on hand for that. We at Wobcom are using NixOS with Morph, but generally use what you are used to, what you feel good with, Ansible, Puppet, Chef, whatever you are comfortable with. Okay. I hope I could give you some ideas on how to improve your DNS setups. Do you have any questions?
Yes, there are. There are some questions. Let's start with the most top-rated one. How do you monitor for the different instances for correct operation? I think most of it was already answered after the question was pasted to the system. How long does it typically take until the network doesn't send requests to the dead server anymore?
So that really depends on your routers and how recent they are, how fast they are to put the new routes into the ASIC. But since it's just a few routes, it just should maybe 1 or 2 seconds, probably less.
Okay. How do you automate to take the Anycast node out of service, i.e. drop the routing before updating?
Oh, we just take down the BGP sessions.
So you do it manually?
Yes, manually, but you can also automate this with, for example, Ansible or whatever. Just make sure to put in some safeguards that you don't take down the whole fleet.
Okay. And I think one last question, as we are on time, do you use DOH, DOQ, or any other new DNS over something feature?
No, it should be easy to integrate in the current setup, but we don't currently.
Okay. Okay, then thanks for your talk. There will be the breakout room later for the unanswered questions, and then see you soon.